She's not what you'd expect. She's tough and feisty, but gentle and tender. She makes millions and gives millions to the poor. She cries, she laughs, she teaches, she comforts. This is the Dani Johnson Show.
Hi, and welcome to the Dani Johnson Show. We are very, very blessed that you decided to join us today. Today is that one day out of the week that we kind of set apart for the deeper spiritual issues, those parts of your life that maybe you don't realize are spiritual. You know, things like fear are spiritual. Things like success are spiritual. Even finances are spiritual. So today's the day that we come from a spiritual perspective. And today we're going to talk about something that really will help you to succeed. I am very, very confident that you're going to have an aha moment today, as I did when I read these particular important quotes and passages and ancient wisdom that is so very powerful, still alive to this day. I also believe that not only are you going to have an aha moment, but you're also going to have a plan of attack, if you will, moving forward and helping your life to succeed in every area of your life, whether it be your finances or your family, your career, your physical body, whatever it is that you want to succeed in today, I believe that you're going to get exactly what you need here on the Dani Johnson Show. So because it's a spiritual show, we have no commercials today. We're going to go straight into the content. And you know what? I kind of want to invite you into my own living room, if you will. And in my house, I am one of those strange women that, yes, I really like to pray. So I'm going to start with a word of encouragement and blessing to pray over your life. And then we're going to go right into these incredibly powerful pieces of wisdom that I hope you hold near and dear to your heart. Father, I thank you so very much for my friend who is listening. I thank you, Father, for this conversation that we're going to be able to have. And I pray that your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, would come upon us and speak to us directly. Help to grow us and to move us in the direction that you desire for us. You're an awesome, loving Father, and you desire for us to be free. You desire for us to succeed. You desire, just as any parent would desire for their children, to be blessed abundantly and to prosper greatly and to be in good health. I thank you that you are the one who cheers us on and that you are for us and that you are not against us. Father, I pray that your revelation comes and really penetrates us greatly today with the message that we are going to be talking about. Bless your word in our ears, giving us ears to hear, eyes to see truth, that we would not be the same, that something would move and shift, even be an earthquake inside of our very being and inside of our soul, so that we can be an awesome testimony of your good work. We ask for these things in the name of your Son, the prophesied Messiah, Yeshua, that is Jesus. Amen. Okay, well, there's something that's been kind of working on me for the last several months. And when I was praying about what we would have a discussion about today, this was clearly the thing that I felt that we were supposed to discuss. What's been working on me? Well, a couple of years ago, I decided that being disciplined was like no longer fun. That, in fact, especially in the area of food, okay? So in the area, because my husband, he has been very, very blessed that he's been able to maintain a pretty awesome physique without being very disciplined with food. Well, at night, mommy, Dani, the wife, I definitely cook great meals for the family, and they are very, very healthy. You know, once in a while, it is fried chicken, mashed potatoes, and gravy smothered in butter. Don't forget the corn smothered in butter and the green beans. But that's an unusual thing. In general, the family has a lot of vegetables and, you know, a lot of a good balance of proteins and things like that. And so he's been pretty blessed for the last 25 years to maintain a pretty good physique with the erratic workout type thing. You know, sometimes he does, sometimes he doesn't. But he has this incredible love for sugar, especially junk food. And don't forget the Covers burgers, okay? So the drive-thrus, all of that stuff. And I've just always stayed away from those things. Been very, very disciplined purposely for that, because I come from a family that had obesity issues, and I also had a weight problem from 18 to 22. I was 50 pounds overweight 4 different times. I gained and lost those 50 pounds. And so honestly, I'd been very, very disciplined, and that discipline spilled over in other areas of my life. For example, in business, it spilled over in my relationships. It just, you know, I just wanted to grow in certain areas. Well, a couple years ago, I just said, you know what? forget about it. And I decided, so I'm going to eat with my husband. And it did not take very long before I was nearly shooting up into my veins sugar in the form of Skittles, in the form of Reese's peanut butter cups and those Reese's Pieces that are so good. And I found myself at 9:55 at night, 5 minutes before Cover's, this incredible hamburger stand that is near our house. It's largely in the South and in the Midwest. Oy, you can find it in Chicago. The Butter Burger. It's the home of the Butter Burger. Are you hearing me? Oh, it's literally fried in butter. And butter is like my best friend. Okay, so not really. But, you know, when it comes to food, me and my butter. Anyway, so I found myself even craving things like Taco Bell and Taco Casa. I mean, that has just never been in my, not never, but largely has not been in my DNA to go towards, right? So other people eat that. I'm like, no thanks, you know, and I didn't even have a taste for any of those things for a long, long time. But here, I did, by the way, when I was 50 pounds overweight, four times from 18 to 22, I ate all kinds of junk food and drive through and all that kind of stuff. So 2 years ago, I'm like, you know, forget about it. I'm just forget it. You know, big deal. So I gain weight and I move into one size up, which would be a size 8. Who cares? That's not that bad. You know, I'm pushing 50. I'm all right if I get myself up to a size 8. And it's going to be okay. Well, something happened. So I let myself go. I did. That was my confession. I let myself go. And all of a sudden, like, I'm wanting Skittles for breakfast. I want ice cream. I want those root beer floats. I'm making all kinds of crazy desserts, like, all the time. Okay, I'm not just making my big giant bowl of popcorn that's smothered yellow butter. No, now I'm turning that into caramel corn. I have this great recipe, by the way. You can make caramel corn in 10 minutes versus an hour and a half, 2 hours, and burning yourself with candy. No, I have this great recipe. Anyway. So I found myself wanting and yearning for more sugar. I found myself wanting and yearning for more of a lot of things that I shouldn't have been eating. Boy, gosh, I mean, the food even that I was cooking at home. So yeah, I put on a few pounds. I'm sure you noticed. Be nice. Anyway, so I put on a few pounds, and then I ended up with some tumors. Some fibroid tumors are totally non, you know, nothing to worry about. And I did everything natural to try to get rid of them. Of course, you know, they say, you know, stay away from dairy, stay away from sugar, stay away from. It was, like, so hard. But I did it. It did not help. I ended up having to have the tumors removed. And I remember at the height of where my tumors were growing, I had the, I really wanted my stomach back. I wanted my flat stomach back because my stomach, you know, I was about 6 months pregnant is what I look like in Danny's pregnancy that I had. You know, I've had 5 kids, so I know what 6 months pregnant looks like on my body. So the long and the short of it was I had this incredible revelation. As I'm recovering from my surgery, my daughter, who came to stay with us, she lived with us for about a month, helping me to get back to better health. It was quite an intensive surgery that I had. So she took care of the house and she took care of cooking and all of that kind of stuff. So right away, I'm like, I just want to get healthy. You know, after you've had surgery, you just want to get healthy, right? So long story short, my daughter is the movie marathon queen. And when she gets together with my husband becomes the movie marathon king. They decided that they wanted to watch the Rocky series. That's what they wanted to watch. They wanted to watch the Rocky movies. Now, you might be saying right now, Dani, what does it have to do with spiritual things? I promise you, it has everything to do with spiritual things. You see, you live out your spiritual life in your everyday life. You see, your spiritual life is not at church on Saturday or Sunday or a Bible study that you do on Wednesday. That is not your spiritual life. Your spiritual life is lived out in everything you do every single day. Everything you do every single day. Every choice that you make is a spiritual choice. You're like, no, it's not, Dani. Oh, sure, it is a spiritual choice. And I'm going to show that to you as we move forward. You see, how you live out your job or your work or your business, those are spiritual issues. Are you following spiritual concepts? Are you using your will? Are you making decisions that are right, that are good, that are noble, that are pure, that are praiseworthy? Are you living out your work life in excellence and diligence, which are spiritual concepts and principles? Your finances, where you're spending your money every day, those are spiritual issues. Are you following according to what the Bible says on how to create wealth? I'm not talking about the name it and claim it prosperity gospel. I'm telling you the Bible teaches you specifically how to create wealth, and it also teaches you specifically how to end up poor. In fact, we'll touch on one of those here today. So poverty and wealth can be spiritual issues, your work life, absolutely, as well as your form of parenting or how you are as a spouse or how you're going about finding a spouse. All of these things are spiritual issues. And finally, how you treat your body. Yes, what you put into your body is a spiritual issue. The food you are feeding your body with, the liquid you are putting into your body, those are spiritual issues. Okay, so here we are. It is now going to be the Rocky, yes, marathon. Something happened really powerful for me in this. And actually, it started even before that, watching the state of where our nation is right now. And there'd been a voice that kind of had been rising up talking about winning and that we have to stop losing as a people, as a nation. And so that actually started to seed and further this message that really challenged me. And I hope and pray that it challenges you as well and moves you from the place, maybe if you're in a rut or you're kind of stagnant right now, or you need to be refreshed and or refined, or you're feeling like, gosh, I'm just kind of dry and I really want to move myself ahead. Maybe you found yourself in a place where you're kind of unmotivated. You don't really have anything that's pushing you and pulling you in a direction that is better and helpful for everyone that is around you. If that's the places you're in, that's where I have found myself many times throughout my life. And so here, the Rocky movies begin. And the very first one, which I hadn't seen in years, right? And I highly recommend that you watch them. I think there's 8 of them. There's a total of 8, including the movie Creed, which was phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. But watching this series all the way from the beginning, all the way to the end, in 2 days, okay? We started it at 10 o'clock at night, ended at 2 a.m., and then picked it up at 11:30 the next morning and watched it all through the night and finished the entire series by Sunday. I think it was Sunday afternoon. So 2 days and, well, if you do the hours, it's like 48 hours or something like that. So Rocky 1, you know, had such a powerful message. I remember when I saw it years ago, I thought, it's kind of slow. But when for some reason, my eyes were opened to see it from a different perspective. Number one, Sylvester Stallone. Man, this was his very first movie, and he won major Academy Awards on this thing. And the movie was actually filmed in less than a month. It was written in 3 weeks, and it's a phenomenon. It really is, and the entire series has such powerful messaging in it. But one of the things that I picked up from this story was self-discipline. Yeah, being a champion, competing in a place where you're unqualified, and setting specific goals that are appropriate for where you're at. Okay, so in the movie, obviously, is ending in his fight against Apollo Creed, right? Who is the champion? He's the national boxing champion who's well trained, right? He's trained excellently, incredibly disciplined, right? And has the best trainer, and he's very wealthy, and he's very famous, and all of this stuff. Well, here's Rocky Balboa, who is going against this champion, and he's never had a fight like this ever in his life, and it really was just a PR fight. But his entire goal was not to beat Apollo Creed, but to go all 12 rounds. And that was his goal, and that was his victory. So at the end, both were victorious, and unfortunately, Apollo Creed got a rub like he was not expecting. He was expecting to lay Rocky Balboa down in the first or second round. But the fact that Rocky was able to go the whole 12 rounds was something that he had disciplined himself to do, and that, to him, birthed a champion in him. That told him, I'm a champion. That I could go 12 rounds with the champion of the world shows me that I'm a champion. So what are we talking about? We're talking about self-discipline. Yeah, we're talking about that. Why? Because I told you that 2 years ago, I decided that self-discipline just wasn't worth it. It just wasn't worth it. So let's go to the ancient passages that talk about self-discipline and discipline and the form of it for our lives, because I believe that you're called to be a champion. And I don't care what your personality is, there's something in you that wants to be a champion. You see, I don't think anyone likes losing. I think everybody enjoys winning. It's why all different types of personalities watch the Olympics and watches sports, why we go to our kids' games. winning is something that I believe that has been put inside of us. It's a desire that's been put inside of us. Now, there are some personalities that, like, they take the winning thing, like, over the top, and they would die for it. And you know, I believe that there's a balance is important. But when winning becomes your God, there's a problem, for sure. But when winning no longer matters and you don't care about it, and it's not anything that you even ever think about, whether it's winning in the marketplace, it's winning, you know, you're against your war on debt. If you've been to First Steps to Success, or you've collected the materials that we have on War on Debt, where you could become debt-free in the next 5 to 7 years, and now you're winning that war against your debt, because there is an enemy, and your enemy is debt, and it's strangling you, and it's poverty and things like that. Whether it's winning that next promotion in your work life, that you're growing, that you're establishing your reputation, that you're winning a better reputation there, that you're winning in marriage, right? If you're married, that your marriage is winning against what? Winning against divorce, that it's winning against being bored in marriage, that it's winning against being status quo and you know, not having passion in your life, and not having intimacy of communication and intimacy even physically with your spouse, but you just kind of tolerate each other. That's not winning. That's so losing, right? And even winning as a parent, that you're not going to choose to raise your kids according to the standards of what everybody else does, which is, you know, give birth and hope for the best, but that you are choosing to be a champion as a parent, and that you are championing the cause of the next generation being better off than your generation, that you're going to impart wisdom, knowledge, and understanding into your children so that they have a much better start. They're starting from a higher platform. They're springboarding from your shoulders into greatness, that they're not going to struggle in the same financial ways that you did, that they won't struggle in the same heart issues that you did, or emotional issues, or relationship issues, or work issues, because you are championing the cause of, I'm going to make sure to be the best that I can be as an example, as a leader in the home, whether I'm the mother or the father, and I'm going to champion my children to learn from what I've learned from, but not make the same mistakes that I've made, and to impart in them and put them into places that maybe my parents didn't know to put me in, but I'm going to put them in places that are going to be better for them. Okay, that's one thing I love about our clients who are parents who have brought their children to First Steps to Success. You know, 7 years old and up, where their kids have gained an education month after month after month at First Steps to Success, where these parents have invested into their children to do that. In fact, just recently, incredible story. Talk about something spiritual. A mom and a dad who've brought their son and daughter to First Steps to Success. And while they were there, they had this entire vision get birthed in them. They were 8 and 13 years old, right? And these two kids got a vision for taking care of people who could not take care of themselves. They caught the vision of the 1,000 home project. They left that seminar saying, we want to help build 3 homes for the extreme poor. They have no food. The poor that has no water. They have no shelter to speak of. They have no electricity. They have no job. They have no future. Here, an 8 and a 13-year-old caught the vision of a company that is building 1,000 homes for the extreme poor, and they said, we want to build 3 of those 1,000 homes. So they went home and they started a business. Think about this. They went home and they started a business, very disciplined. How? They learned how at First Steps to Success. They learned the basics of starting a business. They learned the basics of presentation. They learned the basics of how to pitch and market a product. They created the product themselves, which were little truffles made out of coconut, nuts, and dried fruits. Some of them with chocolate, some of them without, okay? Beautifully packaged and wrapped with the story of why they started this little company, an 8-year-old and a 13-year-old. So with excellence and diligence, which, by the way, is a spiritual concept, okay? It's a spiritual principle, excellence and diligence. The Bible talks a lot about that, and that's how you prosper. In fact, the Bible says diligent hands lead to wealth. That's in Proverbs. So they diligently packaged this product, made this product, and began to market this product. Again, an 8-year-old girl, a 13-year-old boy. So then they're at the next training seminar at Creating a Dynasty, which is our advanced leadership conference. Again, look at these parents, this mother and father who did not get the education that they are currently getting in their 30s and 40s at first steps and creating a dynasty for relationships, the education for their getting about money, learning to become investors, learning to pay off all of their debt, learning to live rightly financially well below their means, as well as for their careers. They're learning business skills and tools and strategies that are growing their careers and growing their income. So they didn't learn that stuff when they were kids. So they're like, why not make sure rather than take my kids to Disneyland, I want to give my kids a future. And rather than taking them to Knott's Berry Farm or Disney World or Six Flags, because it's the same amount of money. The amount that you invest into your family going to places like that is a crazy amount of money. Not to mention people crying in line, standing in line, how many rides you actually get to go on, what, 5 or 6, and you're sweating your guts out all day long, eating nothing but terrible, horrible food that is bad for you. You leave with a gut ache, stressed out, hearing all kinds of people speak language that you didn't want your kids by, and everyone's whining and crying because they're tired. So these parents decided, rather than taking our kids to things like that, we're going to put our kids in front of DaniJohnson.com. We're going to put them in front of First Step Success in Creating a Dynasty. Now check it out. So by the time he got to Dynasty, which is just 2 months after this 13-year-old started his business, his name is Deke, Dietrich, so he goes by Deke. Okay? 2 months later, he'd already sold enough truffles and 100% of the proceeds go to building the houses. So he and his sister already made $3,000 in 2 months. These are two kids. So at Creating a Dynasty, I'd heard about this. And so what happened? I was teaching a section on designing your life, giving very specific strategies on goals, pulling out the vision out of you, pulling out destiny out of you, helping you design the life that you want to live, and talking about our strategic goal planning. Well, I had heard about this young man, about what he had done, and I brought him up on stage and asked him, you know, look, this is what happens when someone gets a vision and they diligently work towards it. They are self-disciplined, even though they have no idea how to do the job. Even they have no idea how to, but they're stepping out in faith, very disciplined, very focused. He learned some skills. He applied those skills. And wow, he's already generated $3,000 towards, and I asked him, what's your goal? $16,000. Okay, so he needed another $13,000. Out of the blue, my friend, out of the blue. People started getting up out of their seats, going, and this kid's on stage, and throwing money at his feet, shaking his hand, saying, thank you. You just inspired me. Thank you. Okay, well, what happened in the next 30 minutes was an absolute shock. Not only did his $13,000 come in, no, $500,000 came in. $500,000 came in 30 minutes. Did you hear what I said? $500,000. $500,000 came in 30 minutes. How is that possible? Because that's what happens when you're disciplined. That's what happens when you are a champion. That's what happens when you know you're called to be a champion. You step out and do things that you don't think you're capable of doing. You step out regardless of what your qualifications are or not, regardless of what your age is or not, regardless of who you know or not. You step out for that goal like a champion, and that young man obviously got championship results. So let's turn to this passage. It's Proverbs 13:18. Again, that's Proverbs 13:18. It says, poverty and shame will come to him who neglects discipline, but he who regards reproof will be honored. I'm going to say that again. Poverty and shame come to him who neglects discipline. Poverty and shame come to him who neglects discipline. That's terrible. You see, we are living in an incredibly undisciplined society. We are. We have become a very undisciplined people. How do we know? You can just walk around, whether it is at the grocery store or at church on Sunday or in your office, and you can see the thumbprint of an undisciplined life on the physical bodies and on the faces of those that are around you. Listen, I have lived my fair share of an undisciplined life. I have. And I have suffered the consequences and the shame of my undisciplined life, especially in my early years when I was a homeless woman. That was all because of being undisciplined. I suffered shame being a homeless woman 25 years ago because of my undisciplined life. I was undisciplined with food. I was undisciplined with my time. I was undisciplined in my relationships. I was undisciplined sexually. I was undisciplined emotionally, mentally, spiritually, financially. And because I was undisciplined, it led me into terrible relationships that were toxic, a failed marriage, $2.03 to my name, a $35,000 debt, and being completely suicidal. So poverty and shame is what is set aside, comes to him who is undisciplined. You don't want to be undisciplined, because you and I both know that discipline leads to success. It does. And in this case, it says that it leads to honor. Let's go to Hebrews 12:11. This is a really powerful passage as well. It says, "All discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful, but sorrowful. Yet to those who have been trained," keyword, "those who have been trained by it, afterwards it yields peaceful fruit of righteousness." Think about that. Isn't it so true? You see, living an undisciplined life in the beginning seems like it's going to be a blast, doesn't it? It's very enticing, isn't it? It totally is. Being undisciplined. In fact, we even look at that as like freedom. Like, yeah, man, I got freedom to eat whatever I want. I got freedom to go wherever I want. I have freedom to do whatever I want with my time. I got freedom to buy whatever it is that I want. I got freedom to have the friends that I choose to have friends with. And you know what? These family members over here, I can't stand them. I want nothing to do with them. Okay? I got freedom to do whatever I want in my work life. Okay? Let me ask you, what is the fruit of your freedom? What is the fruit of your undisciplined life? So I got really, really convicted, friend, not too long ago, just a little short while ago, where I obviously had been trained by discipline after I was a homeless woman. I got very, very disciplined in each area of my life, and it produced a tremendous amount of success. In fact, I became a millionaire inside of 2 years. I built a large business that was very, very profitable. I started with no debt in that business at all. The business has always been debt-free. I had lost my weight. I had found love in a relationship, and I found my Savior. I found my relationship spiritually with my Father in heaven through the Son, Yeshua, Jesus, the Christ. And so it changed my life, no question. But like I told you, a couple years ago, I decided, I'm like, you know, I just don't want to be disciplined in this area anymore. I don't want to be disciplined over here. And you know what happened? I found that the lack of discipline with food and the lack of discipline with taking better care of myself, that started to bleed into other areas. As I had to start loosening my belt notch, I also noticed that I had become more loose and with my tongue. I had become more loose with my mind. I had become more loose with my thoughts. I become more loose inside of my heart, not in a good way, not in a good way at all. You know, I think it's important to be loosed of things, but in this case, I had become just more lackadaisical, and I found that I was more tired now. I found that I didn't care about a lot of things anymore. I found that I was losing motivation. I found that I was losing vision. I was losing my passion for you to succeed, losing my passion for us together to go build things that are dynamic, for us to go do something that is powerful in life, for us, you know, and to build companies and help to develop leadership and help to speak to those who are broken down and downtrodden and feeling like complete losers and failures, and helping to encourage them that they can step up, rise up, and do something great with their life. And then all of us getting together and taking care of the extreme poor, going and building these 1,000 homes, you know, in the extreme impoverished areas of the world. And so, as well as taking care of the kids in the sex trade and everything else that we do here in the U.S. as well as out of the U.S. So I found that losing my self-discipline in a small place bled into bigger things. And I began to be tired of all things. I began to watch my tongue start to get critical. I no longer was directing my tongue in a disciplined way to encouragement and edification, but now I just started seeing everything that was wrong. I just started seeing everything that wasn't being done right. I just began to focus on things that really started to make me think negatively, and I found that my joy just was not complete. My joy was like not there. You know, I didn't have a positive outlook on where I was going or where other people were going, but instead I just saw the flip side of the coin that was just nasty. It's just treacherous. All I saw was the hard work and the again, when you're negative, you don't see the good results. You know, all you see is all the hard work and you question whether or not it's worth it. Do you know what I mean? You don't see the flip side of it. All you see is the risk. You know, when your head has gone negative and when your mind is sick, all you see is the risk, the work, the cost. You do not see the reward and the future and the eternal rewards. You just don't pay attention to any of those things because all you see is everything that's just so hard and it's taking so long and all that kind of stuff. So all discipline for the moment seems to not be joyful. It seems to be sorrowful, okay? And isn't that so true? In fact, have you ever attempted to go on a diet? Have you ever attempted to say, okay, I'm not going to eat sugar. I'm going to stay away from carbohydrates. I'm going to eat, you know, 1,200 calories a day, whatever it is. You know, I'm going to start working out 5 days a week, right? Have you ever done that? Have you ever like made a plan and said, I'm going to get disciplined here? In the beginning, right, it seems very sorrowful. There's no fun in it. There's absolutely no fun at all. There's no fun in crucifying your addiction, okay? It sucks. It's terrible. It's hard work. You just don't want to do it. You want to quit, right? Okay, and that's what this is saying right here. Like, it is not joyful, but it is sorrowful. But in the end, what is discipline? What does self-discipline produce in the end? It produces peaceful fruit of righteousness. That's what it produces. Peaceful fruit of righteousness. Now you're like, Dani, I could care less about righteousness. Oh, you should care a whole lot about righteousness. You should care a lot. But what does righteousness have to do with my work life? It has everything to do with your work life. Because the righteous are going to inherit the wealth of the wicked. Okay? Now, according to the Bible, laziness is wickedness. Okay, what else is wickedness? Not honoring your boss or the owner of the business is wickedness. It's insubordination and rebellion and witchcraft, according to the Bible. Okay, what else is wickedness? Yeah, wasting money, according to the Bible, is wickedness. What is righteous? Living your life by faith, following what it is that the Bible says on how we should live. And if you do that, it produces wealth in every area of your life. Emotional wealth, mental wealth, spiritual wealth, relational wealth, social wealth, physical wealth, and financial wealth is produced if you seek after righteousness. Righteousness is love. It produces joy. It produces peace. It produces hope. It produces the gifts of the Holy Spirit. You know, prophecy, discernment, healing, motivation, wisdom, knowledge, understanding. The list goes on and on and on of all of the amazing things that come out of your righteousness. And your righteousness, you know, according to this, is if you allow discipline to train you. So discipline is a trainer. So is reproof. Or trainer, what is reproof? That you're being admonished, okay? That you're submitting yourself to leadership, that you're allowing to speak into your life to bring correction in the places that are absolutely necessary to bring those places where there is a lack of righteousness, right? If you're an independent, rebellious, stiff-necked person, you're only going to end up fired, divorced, and hated, okay? I think common sense tells us these things. But if you are one that you are disciplined in nature, that you allow discipline to train you, that, you know, if you're cursing, you're using profanity, and that is something that you want to stop, well, then that's where you need self-discipline, right? If it is that you want to lose weight, we need self-discipline. And by the way, self-discipline and self-control is the same. In fact, the word that is used here in the Greek, discipline, is the same word that's used as self-control. So self-control is the fruit of the Spirit. And we all need the fruit of the Spirit. Let's go here. 2 Timothy. I didn't put the rest of the reference down. That was silly. Okay, so in 2 Timothy, it says, for Yahweh, okay, your Bible might say God, but every place that it says God or Lord, they actually just replace the original name of God. And I love using God's original name. I really do, because I feel connected to him versus God. There's 35 million gods out there. duh. Okay, which one? Okay, but this one has a name, right? And he loves his name to be spoken. For Yahweh has not given us a spirit of timidity. Other translations have communicated that as fear. You've not been given a spirit of timidity, but of power, of love, and discipline. Discipline. Yes, why? Because discipline produces righteousness. Discipline. Being self-disciplined. Now, how do you become self-disciplined? You need the Holy Spirit is what you need. Okay, there's lots of people that don't have the Holy Spirit or are very, very disciplined. That's a gift from God, no question. Being self-disciplined is a gift from God. But he says that there's a gift that you want to ask for it. But we know that according to Galatians 5:22, that self-control, which is discipline, self-discipline, is of the fruit of the Spirit. And so if you walk in the Spirit, you are going to have self-discipline, self-control with your food, self-control with your physical body, self-control with your mouth, self-control with your spending habits, self-control with the relationships that you choose to have, self-control with where you make investments, where you choose not to make investments, what you do with your time. Right? Because when we're undisciplined with our time, we often can end up fired because we're distracted. We're on Facebook. We're watching something we shouldn't be watching. We're wasting time, or we're wasting time in fear in this particular scripture. Again, in 2 Timothy, for Yahweh has not given us a spirit of timidity, fear, cowardness. He's not given us, but of power, which is, hello, power. Okay, that's the spirit he's given us. He's the spirit of power, the spirit of love, and the spirit of discipline. Welcome that spirit of discipline. Welcome that spirit of love and power into you. That is what defeats fear, timidity, and being a coward. Okay? That's what defeats and helps you get out of your rut or that stale place that you're living or that place of pretending, which so many of us do and we've all done from time to time where we're pretending things are great, but inside nothing's great. Okay? We are pretending out to everybody else and acting like everything's fine, but it's not fine. Internally, you're fearful. You don't even know that you're fearful, maybe. But in this case, discipline, okay, helps to bring about the things it is that you want in your life. Now, let's end with this. 1 Corinthians 9:24 through 27. And I know you've heard this before, okay? And again, this all goes back to the Rocky movies. And if you want to kind of be inspired with discipline, because a champion does not win unless he is disciplined, okay? And Paul talks about winning a lot in chapter 9 of 1 Corinthians. So here it is, verse 24. It says, "Do you not know that those who run in a race, indeed, all run, but one receives the prize? Run in such a way to win," it says. Run in such a way to win the prize. Now, running a race just to run a race, you train yourself much different versus the one who is running to be the only one that wins the prize. That person's level of self-discipline is much different than the guy that's just running the race because everybody else is running the race. So which one are you? Are you running to win the race? Are you running because everybody else is running in the race? Verse 25, "And everyone who competes controls himself in every way, disciplines himself in every way. Now they do it to receive a corruptible crown, something that perishes. But we compete for an incorruptible crown, something that does not perish. Therefore, I run accordingly, not with uncertainty. He runs to win, not runs just to run, not runs for a prize that is going to burn, but he runs with certainty that he knows that he's going to win. He trains himself to win. He says, thus I fight, not as one who beats the air," because I don't box with the air. "I fight to win." Verse 27, "but I treat my body severely and make it my slave, lest having proclaimed to others, I myself might be rejected." Okay, look at this. There is such a mouthful here, and unfortunately, we're running out of time. Let me just go over that one again. "But I treat my body severely and make it my slave." That's self-discipline, okay? I am purposed in what I'm putting in my body. I am purposed what I am putting into my mind. I am purposely disciplining myself to win okay? Lest having proclaimed to others that I myself might be rejected. He's saying, I choose to live by example, that what I teach, what I proclaim, what I preach, I live. So I treat my body severely. I am disciplined with my physical body, because if I am not disciplined with my physical body, I have no room to talk to anybody else about self-discipline. I have no room to talk to anyone else about winning or being a champion. I have no authority, and I will be rejected. If I don't have the results in my life that show that I am disciplined, then I have no right talking. So listen, you might have 150 pounds to lose, or you might be severely out of shape, like I am. And I'm working on it, okay? I've started a new regiment for my life. And the reason being is that if I can't break through my own excuses, if I can't break through my own laziness, if I can't push myself to be better, then I am setting an example for everyone else that is around me, that they don't need to push themselves to be better, that they don't need to strive in discipline and to train themselves for excellence, for diligence, and for being a champion. But instead, just laze out, man. Just take a chill pill. Listen, there is a time to take a chill pill, but it is not every day. It is not every day. And the bottom line is this, is how you lead at home and in the marketplace determines what kind of authority you are received with. Yes, the authority. If you want to be heard, then be someone who is self-disciplined with results. If you are someone that you want to be respected, respect is something that you earn, and I believe largely you earn it through self-discipline. In the self-discipline of training yourself for reigning, training yourself in your skills with people, training yourself in your skills in your spiritual life, training yourself in your skills with your finances, training yourself in wisdom, training your physical body so that you can actually run this marathon called life, and that you actually are not going to quit, but that you're going to race it to win it, and you're in it to win it versus being in it to just lose it and to just say that you were in it. And so I hope that today's message challenged you as much as it challenged me. Because by the time I got to Rocky III, I was bawling my eyes out. Was it Rocky III? I think it was Rocky III. And one of the things that the coach said to Rocky, the sweet, sweet Jewish coach, he said, the worst thing that happens to a champion is being civilized. And here Rocky Balboa is sitting in his huge mansion with his crystal chandelier in his gorgeous suit with his big old fat 1980-something or 70-something tie, okay? He's got the big gold watch. I mean, he's like super successful. His hair's all gelled back. I mean, he is just beautiful, right? Beautiful. Versus the white, you know, ribbed tank top in the first movie and the tiny little pair of shorts and the cheap shoes and, do you understand what I'm saying? And the cheap apartment. So here he's in this expensive mansion, and the trainer says the worst thing that happens to a champion is they get civilized. And see, when we get civilized, we get comfortable. Are you in a comfort zone? Have you gotten lazy with your food? Have you gotten lazy with your physical body? Have you gotten lazy with your people skills, your financial skills? When was the last time that you learned something? When was the last time you challenged yourself to sweat something out? That's what this is about today. Because what's on the other side of that self-discipline is the peaceful fruit of righteousness and everything that comes with righteousness. You see, Abraham's faith was attributed to him as righteousness. And God prospered him greatly in every way and prospered his family, multiplied his family. His family is still alive to this day on this planet, to the tune of thousands, actually millions of them, who are still alive 4,000 years later. And how and why his faith was attributed to him as righteousness. So in the beginning, self-discipline sucks. But in the end, whew, you're a champion. How will you feel as a champion? How will you feel knowing you're giving it your best shot and you're winning? How will it feel to no longer walk in that spirit of fear and timidity, but to walk in power, in love, and in discipline? How will you feel? What will be the fruit? What will be the reward on the other side of you being self-disciplined at work, having your mouth be self-disciplined, having your thoughts be self-disciplined, being self-disciplined in your spiritual life, making sure that every day you're starting your life disciplined and studying the greatest success book ever written, this book right here, that every single, yes, day that you're disciplined and seeking your Father in heaven and bringing your plans before Him and asking Him to ordain your steps. Imagine how that is going to feel on the other side. You're going to feel like a champion. You're going to feel like a winner. You're going to feel like you are overcoming the things that have been strangling you and holding you back for years. So, friend, start with the little things with self-discipline. The little things. Like in my case, food is where I decided to go, I don't need to be disciplined anymore, and it bled out into all the other areas of my life. So I went back to, I'm going to get very, very disciplined with food. I am, for the first time in my life, going to exercise. I'm going to do it diligently. I'm going to do it without quitting. I'm going to do it to hit a goal. And now that self-discipline in those little areas are now challenging me to get more self-disciplined in all the other areas. You practice with the little things, you'll become much ruler over much, much more. Okay, we have some people. We made a post just a few minutes ago on Facebook, opening up the lines for prayer requests, if you have one. We would love to pray for you. In fact, we have some people holding right now. In fact, let me grab my handy dandy iPad. The first person that we've got is Sarah Heckerthorne from Palm Beach, Florida. Sarah, welcome to the Dani Johnson Show. How can I pray for you?
Hi. I was just wondering if you could pray for me and my business and finances, just really getting the faith to step out and walk by faith and be self-disciplined.
How are you doing with that right now?
I'm really kind of... I'm on a plateau, you know. I know what I need to do, but just putting it into action and getting over that hill has been a really big struggle for me.
Let me ask you a question. Did you loosen up on your self-discipline?
I did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what's going to change the growth of your business?
Me.
Doing what?
Self-disciplining myself to really do what I need to do and know. I know what I need to do. I just, you know,
choose not
myself,
to do it.
Like you said.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So let me ask you a question. Who's in charge of your actions?
Me.
Yeah. Who's in charge of your thoughts?
Me.
Who's in charge of whether or not your business grows?
Me.
Yeah. So is God in charge of those things?
I trust in Him and His plans.
No, but hold on. He charged you with a business.
Yeah.
And He put you in charge of that business.
Yeah.
So who's in charge of the business?
Me.
Yeah. And who will you answer to?
God.
He's your boss.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's your boss. And He wants to promote you. He wants to grow you. He wants you to succeed. He will help you to succeed as long as you're doing your part.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, so let's do this. I'm going to lead you in a prayer.
Okay.
Okay, say, Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
Thank you for this day.
Thank you for this day.
And thank you for this timely message.
Thank you for this timely message.
And I ask for you to forgive me.
I ask for you to forgive me.
Because you know I've become sloppy.
Because you know I've become sloppy.
I honestly should be fired.
I honestly should be fired.
But because you're so gracious and compassionate.
Because you're so gracious and compassionate.
Rich in mercy.
Rich in mercy.
And slow to anger.
Slow to anger.
I have not been fired yet.
I have not been fired yet.
Forgive me for my lack of diligence.
Forgive me for my lack of diligence.
Forgive me for where I've let my thoughts go.
Forgive me for where I've let my thoughts go.
For what I've let my mouth talk about.
For what I've let my mouth talk about.
Forgive me for what I've chosen to look at.
Forgive me for what I've chosen to look at.
When I know better.
When I know better.
I thank you for your Holy Spirit.
I thank you for your Holy Spirit.
That has been convicting me.
That has been convicting me.
And pointing me to do what I already know how to do.
And pointing me to do what I already know how to do.
So I am guilty as charged.
I am guilty as charged.
And I thank you for the blood.
And I thank you for the blood.
That was shed on the cross.
That was shed on the cross.
2,000 years ago.
2,000 years ago.
For my sin.
For my sin.
For my sin of laziness.
For my sin of laziness.
And distraction.
Distraction.
And the sin of fear.
Sin of fear.
And procrastination.
And procrastination.
I give it to you now.
I give it to you now.
And I receive an exchange.
And I receive an exchange.
Because you say that if I confess my sins.
Because you say if I confess my sins.
Then I will be healed.
Then I'll be healed.
You gave me the gift of discipline.
You gave me the gift of discipline.
And self-control.
Self-control.
In all types of areas of my life.
In all types of areas of my life.
And when I use that gift.
And when I use that gift.
I prosper greatly.
I prosper greatly.
So in this moment.
So in this moment.
I am washed clean.
I have washed clean.
Of all of my sin.
Of all of my
and
sin.
And the mistakes I've made with my business.
Mistakes I've made with my business.
And I start the rest of this day.
And I start the rest of this day.
Purified.
Purified.
And righteous.
Righteous.
Now I walk in that righteousness.
Now I walk in that righteousness.
Which comes with diligence.
Which comes with diligence.
And self-discipline.
And self-discipline.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus'
name. Amen.
Amen.
Awesome. Good job.
Thank you so much.
Sarah, good job. Good job. I'm really, really proud of you and proud of your humility. Thanks so much for calling in. We've got Georgiana Garcia from New Mexico. Welcome to the Dani Johnson Show. How can I pray for you?
I'm here.
Hi. How can I pray for you?
I just didn't keep my eyes focused on God, and I made some really bad decisions. Mm-hmm. And I had an affair, and the man that I had an affair with, I trusted him and took him to the airport, and they drugged me and assaulted me. And now I'm pregnant. I have my tubes tied, but I'm pregnant now. I just really need God to just direct me back into what I was doing, because I know I was the one who lost focus. I know that what I was doing was wrong, and I got myself in this situation. And now I'm getting death threats because I had it reported in two different states.
Wow. Georgiana, I just appreciate your humility. I appreciate your openness. Your transparency is absolutely awesome. I am so, so sorry that you are walking through what you're walking through. And yet on the other side, I am so, so excited for you because I have put myself in some of the worst possible, nastiest, most disgusting situations. And it's when you come to that place of going, I screwed up. This is my fault. I made this mistake. I got off track. It's right then where freedom comes, and it's right then when solutions come. Now, that is not to say that the solutions are easy, right? But it is to say that freedom is on its way. Freedom is on its way. And even when you walk through really hard things, even though at the hand of our own mistake, you know what I mean? These are consequences that you're walking through. God promises peace, Georgiana. He promises peace. Even in the midst of these painful, painful, horrific, tormenting circumstances, he promises peace. And for that heart, and this is what he says, and I love this. I can't tell you how many times I've read this, and it's made me cry my eyes out. He says, I, the high and lofty one, live with the lowly and contrite, which means brokenhearted. And that's you. That's you. He says that he will humble the proud and exalt the humble. When you were walking in the fullness of your, you know, stiff, naked, no, I shouldn't be doing this stuff, you got humbled. And this is the place of humility. and now he will exalt you. This child that is inside of your womb obviously is a miracle, isn't it? Georgiana, are you there? That baby is a miracle. Your tubes were tied. God really wanted this child to be born. That's what he wanted.
I thought the same thing. I didn't get upset. I just said, God, you know, it's your will.
That's right.
You know, if my tubes were tied. And
this is a miracle.
Yeah.
There's no which way or about it, man. This is a miracle. Absolutely. And so I want you daily to speak wonderful things over that baby. Wonderful things over that baby. And call the baby a gift from God. Look at that. Look what he does. In the midst of our sin, while we are yet still sinners, Christ died for us. That's resurrection is in your womb right now, honey. That's what's inside of you. It's resurrection power is inside of you. So that if that doesn't prove and show his incredible love and forgiveness, how amazing. So let's go before him. Say, Heavenly Father.
Heavenly.
You know I'm sorry.
You know I'm sorry.
You know what I've done.
You know what I've done.
And you know the shame that I'm carrying.
You know the shame that I'm carrying.
And I need you.
I need you.
You know I've come to you so many times saying I'm sorry.
You know I've come to you so many times saying I'm sorry.
And today, I want to feel.
I want to feel.
The power of your forgiveness.
The power of your forgiveness.
I want to feel the power.
I want to feel the power.
Of your cleansing. Purifying me.
Purifying me.
Of all of my filth.
Of all of my filth.
And my wickedness.
And my wickedness.
I want today to feel your love.
I want today to feel your love.
In a new way.
In a new way.
Heal me.
Heal me.
Restore me.
Restore me.
I want to feel like I'm your daughter in whom you are pleased.
I want to feel like I'm your daughter in whom you are pleased.
And I choose to believe that I'm made righteous right now.
That I am made righteous right now.
Because of the blood that was shed for me.
Because of the blood that was shed for me.
Cleanses me and purifies me.
Cleanses me and purifies me.
And because of your power of forgiveness.
And because of your power of forgiveness.
I am clean.
I'm clean.
Say, I forgive.
I forgive.
Myself.
Myself.
For this horrible mistake.
For this horrible mistake.
And I release myself.
And I release myself.
And I choose to bless myself.
And I choose to bless myself.
With the same blessing.
With the same blessing.
That the Father blesses me with. I also choose to forgive.
I also choose to forgive.
The man I've sinned with.
The man I've sinned with.
I release him. Yes. Yes. I release him.
I release him.
And he owes me nothing.
He owes me nothing.
Yes. I choose to bless him.
I choose to bless him.
Right now.
Right now.
With the power of Jesus.
With the power of Jesus.
I choose to speak blessing over him. Yes. And over myself.
And myself.
And over the child in my womb.
And over the child in my womb.
Yes. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Georgiana, I am so, so proud of you. This is Dani Johnson. Thank you so much for joining us today. God bless you and get self-disciplined for a better day and for the rest of your life.
If this episode was an encouragement to you, go to DaniJohnson.com and share it with your friends now. You never know who else needs to hear it. This is The Dani Johnson Show.
Hi, welcome to the Dani Johnson YouTube channel. We're super excited to have you here. And every single week, we're gonna make sure that you get awesome videos for your business, career, making more money, saving money, annihilating your debt, as well as helping you to handle those really tough problems that you have with people at home, as well as at work, and taking those really good relationships you already have and causing them to flourish and grow. All you have to do is click that subscribe button right down here. Click that and you'll be subscribed to an amazing community of people, as well as some great videos that will help to improve your life. Thanks so much for being here. Subscribe now would be good. Just click it. I know you can see it. It's somewhere down here. Okay, talk to you later. Bye.